How many of you have played solitaire or poker? How did you learn to play? How do you learn to play a game without instructions? Video games are a unique medium. Unlike the other forms of games and entertainment, the designer has an opportunity to let the player learn to play as they play. The controls, mechanics, and intricacies can be eased on the player when they become necessary. So, how do you teach someone to play your game without using instructions? To learn that, we're going to look toward a personal favorite game of mine, Cave Story. It's an action-based platforming game, and its first level, aptly named The First Cave, is a prime example of teaching the player through playing. Upon starting the game, you're greeted with the title screen, which is actually pretty cleverly designed. The cursor that designates which option you're hovering on, new or load, is actually the player character. With no prior knowledge, this allows you to identify what your avatar will look like while you're playing, since you're controlling him from literally square one. He even moves a little so you can tell it's a character and not some funny icon. Anyway, back to business. The very first part of the game that you see is a tiny cave, and text on screen informs you that it's called Start Point. You begin on a platform over a pool of water, and there are three things that immediately pop out to the player: your vibrantly colored character, the animated objects to your right, and the door above you. After all this, the player's eyes are drawn to the pool of water by the droplets falling from the ceiling. In these first few seconds, the player has been shown all the important aspects of the room, all without even moving. After inspecting your controller, how to move becomes obvious. Whether you're using a controller or a keyboard doesn't matter. The buttons with arrows on them move you in those directions. What's not so obvious is how to jump, and the player must learn quickly, as running off the platform in either direction yields the same result: falling into the pool below you. Now the player is forced to experiment. It quickly becomes apparent that remaining in the pond is not an option, as doing so results in the appearance of the air meter. It rapidly ticks down from 100, creating a sense of urgency that would be lost if it took the same time, but counted from a lower number. In this time, the player is allowed to experiment with the keys on their keyboard or the buttons on their controller. For example, pressing up doesn't jump, as they'll find out, but it just makes the player look up. Assuming the player is using a controller, the process is much quicker since there are less buttons. In the case of a keyboard, jumping is the Z key, which is aptly placed on the opposite side of the keyboard than the arrow keys, directly where the player's left hand will be resting. Either way, they discover the jump button, allowing them to leave the pit. Using their newfound skill of basic motor functions, they can reach the previous objective, the two shiny objects to the right. Previous experimentation revealed that the player can look up, but can they look behind them at the machines? Well, if the up key looks up, then the correct answer must be down. Here, the player learns to interact with the objects, specifically the health and save stations, as well as the door, which allows them to enter the area First Cave. In this new room, the player is greeted with a scrolling camera, a brilliant but subtle way to draw the player's eyes to the dead end before them. Sleeping on the far wall is an odd creature. Assuming the player is curious enough, they'll discover that it's the first enemy in the game, and touching it means getting hurt, signified with flashing red numbers and your health bar dropping, as well as flashing too. Making objects of interest flash is a great way to draw the player's eye. Beyond the wall, the player can see another door that they can't yet reach. Without any words, the player now has a goal: find a way to that door. The only way they can go now is left. Moving back past the first door, the player can clearly see the symbol of a floppy disk next to it. They know the health and save points are in there, so this symbol must be a sign saying that this room is a save point. This will become useful later on in the game as it reappears more and more. If the player chooses to go left, they will be met with sets of spikes. The first ground-based one is easily surpassed, but they need to apply their jumping skills to avoid the second. If they fail, they'll meet their demise for the first of likely many times. If they die, then they learn what happens. They reappear at the last place they saved at. In this case, that's the first room. Moving past those spikes, the player is greeted by a pair of bats. They share a color palette with the previous enemy, implying that they hurt to touch as well. However, unlike the previous one, they do not actively seek out the player. Instead, they just move up and down. The player must learn the behaviors of enemies to succeed, and these enemies serve to show them that different enemies have different behavior patterns, as well as the fact that some enemies might not be locked to the ground. Beyond the bats sits a flashing heart, the same symbol and color of their health bar. It is perched high enough that only tapping the jump button won't cut it. They need to hold it to jump high enough. Learning this skill, as well as applying their previous ability to interact with items, grants them a reward. Their health increases twofold, as the game states. Moving forward, the player is confronted with more bats in another pond. However, this one is different than the last. If they attempt to cross the water on foot, they discover that even their new holding the jump button skill won't work, as the water dampens their jumping ability. In order to reach the other side, they must jump from one end of the pool to the other. This reinforces and challenges their jump-holding skill, as well as foreshadows the difficult jumps the player will find throughout the game. At the end of the cave, there lies another dead end, punctuated by a lion's head. Like every other object in the game, the player can interact with it. Doing so reveals that it's the door to a new room, the Hermit Gunsmith. In the center of the room sits an NPC, or non-player character. Even if the player chooses not to interact with him, they can still tell he's asleep, as shown by the cartoonish Z's coming out from his head. A chest glistens to the side of the screen, again flashing to catch the player's eye. Interacting with it gives the player the Polar Star. The icon displays a small gun, and the player now visibly holds it in front of them. It's not just a cosmetic change, though. The player can indeed use it to defend themselves. In this closed area, they can again experiment with the controls. If one button jumps, then I bet a nearby button shoots. On controllers, this is simple. On a keyboard, it's slightly less so. The Z key jumps, so the nearest letter key, X, shoots. Now that they have a weapon, the player is free to take revenge on the pesky enemies that impeded them before. The enemies now serve a new purpose. The sack-like enemy can be annihilated while standing still, but the bat enemies teach the player to shoot and jump at the same time. Upon defeating enemies, funny little shiny triangle things pop out. They seem harmless enough, bouncing around playfully. If the player tries to interact with them, they will pick them up on contact, giving flashing plus ones, and the other bar above your health increasing. Eventually, the player will learn that if they're hit, the bar drops slightly, and this can happen at any time. If they're not hit, however, the number of enemies in this cave perfectly aligns with the amount of little triangles it takes to fill the bar, which reveals that it levels up the player. Now, their gun is stronger, signified by the new projectile they fire. Back at the first dead end, the player is blocked by strange-looking, well, blocks. Since they look different, it's clear that they're not normal. Shooting them proves this, as they disappear when shot. This teaches the player that they can clear paths for themselves with their gun, not just kill enemies with it. Finally, we find ourselves at our goal, the unmarked door. Approaching the door reveals something unexpected. It's actually an enemy. Like all the rest of the enemies in this area, shoot it to defeat it and reveal the actual door. Entering this door ends the introduction of Cave Story. Teaching a player how to play your game is not easy. Without instructions, it takes clever game design to have a player figure everything out for themselves. Nudging them along and providing them with proper time to experiment can really be a lot more fun, and Cave Story is a perfect example of that philosophy.